This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship this morning at Duke Chapel. We are pleased to have the tabla singers from Raleigh with us today and appreciate the joyful noise that they bring with them. There are a few announcements in your bulletin. This afternoon at 4 p.m., the Choral Society of Durham will continue the second half of Bach's Christmas Oratorio that it began here last night. You may know that this week, Duke Chapel Dean Sam Wells announced that he's accepted a position of vicar at St. Martin's in the Field in London. He, Joe, Lawrence, and Stephanie will be returning to England in May. This leaves us thinking about what their lives will be like without us and what our lives will be like without them. And in the season of Advent hope, we trust that God will be with them and with us and with the Wells family, guiding us and loving us all through life's many transitions. Please rise and join me in celebrating God, the light of the world.
Thank you. Jesus comes into the darkness of our faults and failures, our wrongdoings and our sins. He comes as the light revealing the Father and offering forgiveness, redemption, and peace. Therefore, let us bring our sins to light, that we might more clearly see the Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Christ is the world's peace, who unites us with the Father and with each other. Let us now share words and signs of the peace that Christ gives.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. God, for whom we watch and wait, you sent John the Baptist to prepare the way of your Son. Prepare us now as we hear your word. Give us courage to speak the truth, to hunger for justice, and to suffer for the cause of right. With Jesus Christ our Lord. The Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah, the 61st chapter. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins, they shall raise up the former devastations, they shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. The gospel lesson is from John, the first chapter. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees, and they asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. I wonder what you feel like when you see a photograph of yourself. I know a number of people who claim they always look bad in photographs. Think about the logic of such a conviction for a moment. You see yourself in a photograph. You think, that person doesn't look as beautiful, charming, witty, relaxed, and cool as I like to think I look. Either the equipment must be faulty, or the photographer is useless, or I have a gene that makes me drop all my fine qualities the moment someone points a camera lens at me. Or, and this is perhaps the most likely, I have the kind of warm and effusive personality that's just impossible to capture in a single two-dimensional image. We could simply say that's what the photograph shows, so I guess that's what I look like, and maybe I should deal with it. But no, we say, I always look terrible in photographs. In other words, I know who I am. No one else does. Least of all that cruel, distorting, cold-hearted camera. I know who I am. Do you? Fair enough. You know you're more wonderful, more exquisite in looks, intelligence, character, taste, talent, and style than anyone could describe or capture. Congratulations. But do you really know who you are? One of the features of university culture, with its emphasis on youth, its social media networks, and its transitoriness, is that it gives us innumerable opportunities to present ourselves to one another at our best. Isn't that what a Facebook page is? A chance to say, hey, y'all out there, I'm in the middle of a wild party right now, but I love you, and here's a few photos of me that, of course, don't really do me justice, but at least remind you that I'm lots of fun. We're constantly making it easy for people to understand how brilliant but unthreatening we are. One thing people have started putting on resumes is a little line under their full name that says goal. What follows is a succinct but generic summary of everything they have to bring to the world. Something like, high achiever who selflessly wants to use my outstanding gifts with inevitably less wise and gifted people and to apply my mastery of all technology, including that not yet invented, to bring about lasting change in the world. When we're immersed in such a culture of digitally enhanced appearances and fleeting connections, it's very hard to answer the question, who are you? Instead, we're constantly answering the question, who can I persuade people that I am? What we call successful people are those who've convinced a large number of the public that they're brilliant but unthreatening. And that's why successful people often find this question, who am I, particularly hard to answer, because they've peddled their publicity so many times, they've started to believe it themselves. Success is a drug that makes you think your identity and character are products you can market to unwary consumers. You think you're fooling them, but in the end, the one you're really fooling is yourself. By contrast, when you've had months or years out of work, when you've had the courage to admit the one thing in life you truly want, and yet it's never happened for you, when you've experienced a terrible illness or injury that's left you in need of long-term care, or when you or your family have had to bear a private burden together that, if exposed, would bring down a cloud of public shame. If this is your story, then the likelihood is you do know who you are, even if who you are is a daily struggle with distress, disappointment, or despair. That's one of the few things an experience of genuine deprivation can give you, a deeper understanding of who you truly are. John's Gospel begins with a great sweeping prologue, locating Jesus at the heart of God's purposes and at the heart of the universe. And then we find ourselves abruptly face to face with a man giving testimony, a man also called John. a man who sets up stalls some way from the epicenter of Israel, some way from Jerusalem, from the temple, from the people who decided what was godly, indeed on the other side of the Jordan, outside the traditional boundaries of the promised land. John doesn't have a website. He doesn't have a Facebook page. It's hard to know who he is and what he stands for. Think about the Occupy protesters. They really wind people up. Some of them challenge hygiene norms. And they won't translate their protest into concrete demands, so no one knows who they really are. That's where they get their power. In all respects, they're like John. The high and mighties send their sidekicks to say to John, "Who are you?" He has an answer for them. "I am not." Funny kind of answer. He repeats it several times. There's something almost aggressive about it, but that quickly makes sense when you realize the people John's talking to are messengers from the very same crowd of leaders who'll put both John and Jesus to death 2 or 3 years later. This isn't an idle game of 20 questions where only John knows the answer and everyone else has to guess, and he takes delight in shaking his head and saying, "Uh-uh." This is a cross-examination with John's head on the block. His life depends on his answer. Eventually, John puts his interrogators out of their misery and gives them a straight answer. "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord.'" These words are a quotation from the prophet Isaiah. They're a clear statement from John that he's well in line with the way God has worked over centuries and prepared Israel for this moment. But they also say a lot about John. They say what he is, a voice, where he is, in the wilderness, what he's doing, crying out, and what is really going on, the Lord is coming soon. John is asked the question over and again, "Who are you?" And his answer is, "I can't answer that question except in relation to Jesus." Think about those words for a moment. "I can't answer that question except in relation to Jesus." Is that your answer? The contemporary French film, A Very Long Engagement, tells the story of Matilda, a young woman from Brittany, crippled by polio. She falls in love with a young man named Manek. Manek goes off to fight in the trenches of the First World War. But before he does so, the couple seal their love and promise their hearts to one another. In celebration, Manek takes a knife and carves into the trunk of a great tree the capital letters MMM, which stand for Manek Loves Matilda, the middle M representing the French verb for love, spelt A-I-M-E, but pronounced M. Manek repeatedly carves these three capital letters on trees and paints them on walls wherever he goes. It becomes his signature tune, his logo, the one thing he knows about himself and wants to tell the whole world. But things don't go well in the trenches for Manek. He's accused of injuring himself in order to avoid combat, is court-martialed, and as punishment, in the middle of the Battle of the Somme, is thrust up and out of a trench and pushed into no man's land. That's the last anyone hears of him. His beloved Matilda refuses to believe this is the end of the story. After the war, she hires a private investigator and searches high and low for news of him. She finds a letter from another soldier in the trench. The letter describes Manek's final walk in no man's land and how he was last seen carving into a tree the letters M, M, M. She realizes that at the brink of death, the one thing he knew about himself was his union with her. But she won't stop there. She continues her intrepid investigation, en route finding that Manek had received a pardon from the President of France, but that the pardon had been suppressed by the commanding officer. Eventually, Matilda's all-consuming search bears fruit, and she discovers to her unbridled joy that Manek survived the ordeal, is alive, and is being cared for in a rehabilitation community. A breathless Matilda visits the community and is reunited with her beloved fiancé, Manek. But Manek is a changed man. He doesn't know who Matilda is. He doesn't remember anything about their love or about the trenches. He doesn't know who he is. This is where the film ends. But just imagine how the story might continue. Loving this man and having spent so long searching for him when everyone thought she was crazy and obsessed and chasing an impossible dream, and having finally found him, surely Matilda is not going to stop there. Surely she's going to stay by his side until he learns to think and feel again, until life begins to come back into focus. Even if he can never remember their youth together in Brittany, before too long, all his memories and impressions will be infused with Matilda, just as they were before, only with different details. It's not hard to imagine that one day again, perhaps without knowing, he's done it before, and did it at the defining moment of his life, Manek might get the idea to carve those same three letters into a tree trunk, M, M, M. The truth is, he doesn't know who he is without Matilda. He never did. And now, the other side of hell and oblivion, he never will. That's what John's telling us in saying no to all his interrogators' questions. He's saying, I don't know who I am. I only know who I am in relation to Jesus. I'm a voice. I'm one crying in the wilderness. I'm one making a way for Jesus. I don't have any purpose in life, any goals in life, any satisfaction in life, any bearings in life, any wisdom in life, any security in life, any identity in life aside from Jesus. Jesus is the way I know I am. Think back to the story of Matilda and Manek and their very long engagement. Think of yourself as Manek and Jesus as Matilda. Imagine the story in three scenes. Scene one, before the war. scene two in the heat of battle, and scene three after the war. Some of us identify with the story before the war. Manek could follow a number of paths in life, but he chooses to associate himself with Matilda. In just the same way, for many of us, Jesus is a choice, a figure with whom we choose to identify, and our faith is something from which we could theoretically disentangle ourselves, just as it's possible to loosen oneself from an inauspicious engagement. But others of us might see ourselves more in scene two, at that moment when Manek has been rejected by his own superior officers and thrown into the wilderness of no man's land, and is facing his near certain death. Here, he knows no truth other than Matilda. Will that be us, moments before our near certain death? Will we know no other truth than that Jesus loves us? Will all we know be that Jesus carved his love for us onto the trunk of a tree and has been carving it ever since? And yet again, others of us may feel the most profound portrayal of our faith comes in the final scene of the film, where Matilda, who has already given so much and loved so deep and searched so far, begins to whisper words and make gestures of faithful, abiding love to a man who no longer knows who he is or who she is. Here we are, like Manek, not knowing who we are, where we are, what's going on, hidden away in our own little self-absorbed existence. And here is Jesus kneeling beside us, whispering, playing, teasing, drawing us into this new world that we half remember, half yearn for, partly resist and partly embrace. But without Jesus, we would have no idea of it. And scarcely ever do we realize that it's only possible because of this same Jesus who's here now telling us about it. And one day we may carve our love onto the trunk of a tree, but we might be blissfully unaware Jesus has been in the tree carving business, not just for us, but all along. Without Jesus, we don't know who we are. Sure, we can discover our home, our tastes, our dreams, our sexuality, our colors, our rhythms, our learning styles, our psychological metrics, our star sign, our DNA, our genes, our ancestors' dwelling place, our voice, our family tree. These can all be helpful in their own way. But none of them disclose the most important thing about us. Like John, what really matters about us is to what and to whom we are a witness. What is a witness? A 20th century French spiritual writer had the answer to that question. He said, to be a witness consists not in engaging in propaganda, nor even in stirring people up, but in being a living mystery. It means to live in such a way that one's life would not make sense if God did not exist. That's the answer. John was a mystery to his interrogators, but he knew who he was. He was a living mystery whose life made no sense if Jesus was not coming. Maybe you feel your life makes no sense right now. Maybe you don't know who you are. Maybe your life is a mystery even to yourself. But Jesus has carved your name beside his into the trunk of a tree. Jesus is calling you to be a witness. Jesus is kneeling beside you, whispering your memory and imagination into a life that he has searched you out for and made possible for you to enter. Jesus is the living mystery in whom alone you can discover who you are. Your job, like John, is to live in such a way that your life would not make sense if Jesus did not exist. Amen.
Lord be with you. Let us pray. Mysterious God, our lives do not make sense without you. Orient our purpose, satisfaction, goals, and wisdom in relationship to you. Give your people the discovery of themselves through the gift of your Son. Make us witnesses to your unfailing light and carve your love onto our identities. Occupy our hearts and infuse all encounters with your mercy. Holy God, you sent your servant John to proclaim your coming into the world. Empower us to be people who also testify to the light, so that our lives may become bright and shining beacons that reflect your truth. Lord, in your mercy. Long expected Jesus, we await your coming with eager anticipation and look for you in our midst. Display your glory through all people and clothe us in your righteousness. In a moment of silence, we lift up to you one person or situation in need of a special blessing. Offer a mantle of praise to any with a faint spirit, and make an everlasting covenant with those who wait for you. Be with anyone who lives in the midst of violence. We pray for places in our world too often identified in relation to struggle and conflict: Egypt, Syria, and Libya. Restore a sense of security to victims of crime and establish justice among all people Lord, through your Son, you bring good news to the oppressed. Continue to bind up the brokenhearted, proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners. Guide any in our community seeking to build a new life following a period of incarceration, and support those who walk with them on this journey. Lord, in your mercy. Nurturing Spirit, you shine with a brilliance that no darkness can overcome. Cultivate green shoots of stewardship and cooperation among international efforts for climate change. We pray this morning for students preparing for exams. Stir up in all people a quest for knowledge of you and a pursuit of the enduring truth of your love. Sustain any who are weary this day. Calm the fears of those who worry about the future. Make your love an anchor to communities and families in transition. Replace mourning with gladness, and provide solace to any who grieve a separation from those they hold dear. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you once called John the Baptist to give witness to the coming of your Son. Grant us the wisdom to see your purpose today, and the openness to hear your will, that we too may witness to Christ's coming and so prepare his way. Amen. Today's undesignated offering goes to support human services in the greater Durham area.
you are here today with a heavy heart, ministers will be in the memorial chapel to my right during the sharing of communion. They would be glad to pray with you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, Lord God of Israel, for you have opened the eyes of the blind and unstopped the ears of the deaf. You have made the lame leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. You made this world as a playground of delights, and you called a people to be your companions forever. In Jesus, you showed us who you are, who we are, and how far we have strayed from you, and how to become your companions again. And so our souls magnify you with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending praise. Jesus, you fill the hungry with good things. You show mercy from generation to generation. You show us the cost and glory of your salvation in the breaking and pouring and sharing of bread and wine. Send down your Holy Spirit that your people may be sanctified by your grace, and that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who at supper with the disciples took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup also, gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Delivering God, we call on you to fulfill your Advent promise. May waters break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. Make a highway on which no traveler, not even fools, shall go astray. Bring home those who are in exile. Fill their hearts with singing and shower their heads with everlasting joy. Unite your church. Clothe us with the fruits of your Spirit and fill us with the hope of Advent, the substance of things hoped for and the knowledge of things unseen, until all bow before your throne and worship in your glory, ever one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
In Jesus' sacrifice for us, he carved his love for the whole world to see. Come to Christ's table to find who you are. Come to Christ's table to become who you are. Come to Christ's table to be marked by his love.
Thank you.
Please stand. Lord God, in the gift of your Son, you show us how far you go to love us. We praise you for the mystery of your love carved on a tree long ago and remembered in the bread and the wine of this table. Make us a people who know who we are because of your love. We thank you, dear God, for the blessings of this community. At Duke, we give thanks for the Department of Classical Studies and its explorations of how the ancient cultures of Greece and Rome influenced the world today. Stir up your power, O Lord, and with great might come among us, that the offerings we return and the gifts of our lives may be instruments of your glory in the world. Send us now in the power of your Spirit, that we might be living mysteries, testifying to your goodness and grace. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessings of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.